He is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Today is Easter 4. The word that frames this time of worship is Jubilate. And it is completely possible that you are not jubilating right now or full of jubilate, but we will be full of joy because we will hear the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ and we will rejoice in his blessings, all that freely are given through our Savior, crucified and risen from the dead. Our announcements before our service begins would be that our leaders continue to get you good information about what we're doing in the direction that we're going. And we cannot thank God enough for the leaders of our congregation, council, elders, our president, our head trustee, our head elder, our staff, Myram and Nancy, and we give thanks and praise to God for them and keep them in your prayers. We also see all of our members are they're being very active. We have somebody who's even quite frequently just sewing and making masks for people, and Lord willing, we'll be using those masks here in May so that we can gather in a safe way. I'll tell you more about that in a minute. So also thank you for your stewardship, your faithfulness. We see that our people are rejoicing in the gospel, rejoicing and living under the cross, and continuing to be a blessing. They're not making excuses. They are looking forward to the privilege of serving God's people in the gifts that they've been given. So we thank God for that. We praise God for that. This is the schedule that we are presently set up for. The next two Sundays, or I should say, obviously this Sunday, May 3rd, and next Sunday, May 10th, are going to be live stream services. And then we pray that we can go to the greatest gifts format, May 17th and May 24th. And then, Lord willing, on the day of Pentecost, May 31st, we can go to a fuller participation in the divine service. We don't know exactly what that's going to look like, but we pray we can have a fuller participation even in the greatest gifts weekends. So that's the schedule. The 3rd and the 10th, obviously, live stream. 10th and the 17th. Greatest gifts. Myron will get you more information so you can sign up for that. One of the things we want you to make sure is that no one feels pressured to come. If you still have a challenge, a concern, a susceptibility, no one should feel burdened or pressured to come. You're free. You're free in the gospel. We know your faith. We know your confession. Just as soon as you can get here, we would love to see you. Ascension Day service will still take place. This is definitely an opportunity for us to celebrate our Lordship, our Savior's Lordship at the right hand of the Father over sin, death, hell, and this virus. He reigns. That's where Jesus is right now. So we will still gather. We don't know the format yet, but we'll gather on Ascension Day, May 21st, at 7 p.m. Most likely live stream, but we'll get more information out to you on that. So God's peace be with you and reign with you as we start our service, which will be on page 167. Thank you.
service today is on page 167 in your Lutheran service book, Divine Service Setting 2, page 167. We hear the precious and powerful name of our God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We confess our sins silently before the Lord. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing together our entrance hymn on page 469, hymn 469. We stand.
Sing, raise your joys and
by praying the Kyrie, page 168.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Church, that they may avoid whatever is contrary to their confession, and follow all such things as are pleasing to you, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. May be seated for the reading of God's Word. Our Old Testament reading on this fourth Sunday of Easter is from Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm is Psalm 147. You can either find it in the printout that was provided, or it's in the front of your hymnal. Psalm 147. The antiphon is verse 5, so we sing that first. We sing the psalm of the Gloria Patri, half verse by half verse, and then we come back to verse 5 at the end. Psalm 147, verses 1 to 11.
Our Lord.
epistle is from 1 Peter chapter 2. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him, to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the emperor. Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. For this is a gracious thing. When mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Disciples said to one another, "What is this that he says to us? A little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me, and because I am going to the Father." So they were saying, "What does he mean by a little while? We do not know what he is talking about." Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him. So he said to them, "Is this what you are asking yourselves? What I mean by saying a little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me? Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. When a woman is giving birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered the baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also, you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated as we sing the hymn of the day. It's on page 467. Awake my heart with gladness.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus said, so also you will have sorrow now, but I will see you again. And your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. Jesus meant that. He says, no one will take your joy from you. And Jesus meant that. And then you hear through the podcast, through the messages, through the sermons, through the teachings, through the blogs, don't let anyone steal your joy. Be careful. Don't let anyone take your joy. Seminars, all dedicated to the sorts of things that will steal your joy. One of those things that can steal your joy, people say, are difficult people. Does anybody here like difficult people? Put your hand up if you like difficult people. You love them. You might not like them. Who in their right mind would enjoy difficult people? Working with them or trying to help them? No. And what's worse, it seems like difficult people are everywhere. And the article and the author and the blog and the preacher claim that difficult people will steal your joy. So I guess we just have to get rid of all the difficult people in the world. That's easy enough. And then you're going to have joy. Or should we go with Jesus on this, who says, and I will see you again, and your hearts will be glad. And no one, he says, no one will take your joy from you. One of the things that people say will steal your joy is being misunderstood. It is so frustrating to not have someone understand you, understand what's going on in your life, what's in here and what's in here, and all the frustrations that you have, and you share those things with somebody and you are misunderstood. They always get you wrong. They get your motivation wrong. They get your heart wrong. And so the article or the sermon or the message goes into all the details of how being misunderstood or not heard is such an enormous problem that it can actually steal your joy. You know, I know the guy made a case for it. I know he's got some sort of a education. He's very influential. And he's telling you that this can steal your joy. So I guess we just have to get rid of all the misunderstandings in the world. And then we got a shot at joy. That should be simple enough, shouldn't it? Just get rid of all misunderstandings in the world. And then you get possibly some joy. Or should we go with the Lord of the universe on this, who says, and I will see you again, and your hearts will be glad, and no one, he says, no one will take your joy from you. And he meant that. Another one of the things that people say will steal your joy is scarcity. Does anybody enjoy scarcity? Struggling because of a lack of goods or services. I learned that in a little first grade homework this past week. Thank you, Anna. Scarcity is a lack of goods or services. Being impoverished or not having the flow of things that you need. Scraping by, barely making it. Now the article or the podcast will say that not having something that you really kind of wanted, or even in a greater format, you needed, will steal your joy. Now, this is going to create a whole new problem. We might think that it is our job as Christians to just flood people's life with goods and services and everything that they want, and that's the only way the world has a shot at joy, to get rid of scarcity. Or we could believe Jesus who says, I'm going to see you again. And your hearts are going to rejoice. They're going to leap. And no one will take your joy from you. No one. Another one of the things that the people will say will take your joy or steal your joy is conflict. Does anybody here enjoy conflict? Really? I did meet one guy, and he's still a good friend of mine. The only guy I ever know or have known that actually says he relishes conflict. Love him for it. Dear friend to this day. I won't tell you who it is. But the rest of us, I don't think, enjoy conflict. One article said that a conflict will block your fellowship with God. Conflict will block your prayers. Conflict will block your joy. It'll just flat out steal your joy. You just lose it. So I think what they're basically saying is that if you get rid of all conflicts in the world, that if you get rid of all conflicts in your life and in your relationships and in your family, then possibly you could get some joy. Is that how it's done? And yet Jesus is saying, I'll see you again. And your hearts will be glad. And you will have joy. And no one will take your joy from you. Somebody said, these 25 things block your joy, steal your joy. Regret, dread, worry, perfectionism, a critical attitude, complaining, comparison and jealousy, being ungrateful, negative thinking, unrealistic expectations, entitlement mentality, hurry sickness, focusing only on the destination, not the journey, loneliness, burnout, materialism, living vicariously through your children, self-neglect, people-pleasing, being someone you're not, living too cautiously, performance orientation, guilt, lack of purpose, drivenness versus healthy ambition. Oh my goodness, is that all? Just sounds like all the stuff that's already in our life. It almost makes it sound like joy is so unattainable. It's so inaccessible. Another writer says, 11 toxic behaviors that will steal your joy. Comparing yourself to others, being overly connected to technology, taking things personally, participating in drama, living someone else's dream, striving for perfection, holding onto your vision too tightly, reliving the past, worrying about the future, not making self-care a priority, taking life too seriously. And I guess if you can get rid of all that stuff that we have been doing since Adam and Eve fell in the garden, you can have a shot at joy. So we've got a big problem with all this stuff. Not only does it make it sound like joy is so impossible to find or get, it also makes it sound that if you get joy, that in an instant, even if you were to get joy, in an instant, it could be robbed from you. And I will tell you, no wonder this world is so full of despair. No wonder this world is so joyless. Because we're all trying to attain to joy, and we'll do anything we can to get it our way, our time, our method. And if we were to believe the devil, the world, and our smug, sinful flesh, and what it keeps flushing down our ears, then there would be absolutely no joy left in this world. Now remember, when it is that Jesus said these words
to his beloved disciples. When he says, in a little while you will not see me. And then again in a little while you will see me. He's saying this around the Lord's Supper. His last will and testament. The gifts that he will give us in his body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. He's saying this around the gifts. The gifts of fellowship. The gifts of Holy Communion. On the night he was betrayed, and he talks to them as children. He says, in a little while you will not see me. Because Jesus is going to be betrayed. He's going to suffer. And he's going to die. And how warped is this? That's when the world is going to rejoice. How warped are we? That's when the world has joy. When the Son of Man is dead. He who cleansed the lepers. He who preached the good news to the poor. He who opened up the ears of the deaf. He who made the lame leap like a deer. See, we will do anything to try to attain to joy, and it is the death of man. But Jesus says, so also you will have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. And he meant that. Do you think joy is some sort of an emotional attachment? Some sensationalist maneuver? Do you think joy is some feel-good buzz? Or schmoopy-whoopy sentimentality? The desire or the need to always be happy all the time? That's not joy. That's a pseudo joy. That's a false joy, a fake joy. Your joy was at the Father's side from eternity, as Proverbs 8 says. He was the master craftsman at the Father's side through whom all things were created. And with joy, he was at his Father's side. The joy he had in his Father as all things were brought into the world. Your joy was born of a virgin. He took on our flesh and blood. But was without sin. Your joy was baptized in the Jordan, and he identified with us sinners with all our problems. Your joy suffered for all our misguided joys and died for you. As the whole world turned its back on him and would not own him. Hebrews 12 says, who for the joy set before him? Jesus endured the cross, scorning his shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He considered redeeming us sinners his joy. And your joy was raised from the dead and now reigns to all eternity. There is nothing transient about your joy. Nothing flimsy or shaky. Your joy reigns over sin, over death, over hell, over the grave at the right hand of the Father. And if we really want to get honest about the law and the gospel, does anybody want to get honest about it? Jesus came into the world for difficult people. Jesus came into the world for those who create misunderstanding. Jesus came into the world for those who caused scarcity. Jesus came into the world for those who stir up conflict. The only thing that can keep you from the kingdom is you not believing that. It's just simply not believing that Jesus is the Lord. Jesus says, once you get this joy of forgiveness, no external force, no person outside yourself can wrench it free from you. People can throw it away because they no longer believe that Jesus forgives their sins, but it cannot be taken from you.
consider the joy that Jesus had at his Father's side at the right hand of the Father. Now that he claims you in baptism, you get him in baptism, you get his joy, his life, his forgiveness. And we now pray, our Father who art in heaven. You've been embraced by the Savior who came looking for you, whose joy it was to find you, to bring you into his fold. Now you say, our Father, to your Father in heaven through Christ, as you take up Jesus' words. And the joy that we have because Jesus continues to deliver his joy packages to the means of grace, through his word and sacraments. The joy of God is so accessible. The divorce didn't end your life. That difficult person did not ruin your life. That misunderstanding or this scarcity you deal with or this accursed epidemic cannot keep us from the kingdom. Wherever the gospel and the gifts of Jesus touch down in your life, they deliver to you the joy of the kingdom, which is the forgiveness of your sins. And the highest form of worship, as we learned in Matins on Wednesday, is to seek the forgiveness of sins in Jesus and to know that we have it. To know that it's ours. To know that it's ours. So, consider the joy of the apostles. It would be true. No one could take their joy from them. They were going to experience difficult people, being misunderstood, scarcity, and conflict. And no one, Jesus meant it. No one could take their joy from them. You think about some of our dear saints in our fellowship. I will point us to Deborah Stinson. 2 broken feet. Uncontrollable cancer. Bad back. Bad knees. Bronchitis. Onset of pneumonia. Was just tested for COVID. Doesn't look like she has it. And she has joy. Joy in Christ. She's full of joy, and no one can take it from her. We've got this time of waiting still. We have a little while before we see Jesus here, where he promises to be in his body and blood. That fast will play out. God is doing things in our lives through this fast. But in a little while, we will gather again. We will see Jesus here as he comes to us and gives us his body and blood. And we will rejoice that all the people of God, all the sheep here and the pastors, can get back together with their good shepherd in person. And no one can take our joy from us. In the name of Jesus, amen. May the peace which passes all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We stand to sing the offertory hymn on page 956.
Amen.
We confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed on page 175. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty and eternal God, you are worthy to be held in reverence by all people everywhere. We give you humble and sincere thanks for the innumerable blessings you bestowed on us without any merit or any worthiness on our part. We pray you especially for preserving for us your saving word and the holy sacraments. Grant and preserve to your holy church throughout the world truth and doctrine, and provide faithful pastors to preach your word with power. Help all those who hear the word rightly to understand and truly to believe it. Send laborers into your harvest and open the door of faith to those who do not know you. We pray for Victor Das and Julie as they are on the front lines right now, that you would sustain them by your word and spirit. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, in mercy, bring to repentance the enemies of your church and grant them amendment of life. Protect and defend your church in all tribulation and danger, and sustain with your spirit our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world who experience persecution. Strengthen us and fellow Christians to set our hope fully on the grace revealed in Christ, and help us to fight the good fight of faith, that in the end, we may receive the salvation of our souls. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, bestow your grace on all nations of the earth. Bless especially our country, its inhabitants, and all who are in authority. Let your glory dwell in our land, that mercy and truth, righteousness and peace may abound in all places. Bless also all who serve in our armed forces, that they may serve with integrity and honor. Protect the nurses, the doctors, the first responders, and the researchers who are working to address the pandemic. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Compassionate Lord, graciously defend us from all calamity by fire and water, from war and pestilence, from scarcity and famine, and from every other evil. Protect and prosper all who labor in their rightful calling, and let all use their arts so that your word flourishes among us. Be the God and Father of the lonely and the forsaken, the helper of the sick, the needy and the unemployed, and the comforter of the distressed and those who sorrow. Even in our limited capacity right now, help us to see that we have a calling to be merciful to those around us, however you choose. We do ask that you be with those on our hearts that are sick in our fellowship or friends or family members of ours, as we name them before you. Heal them according to your wisdom. May they ever cling to Jesus as their sure and certain hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Father, as we are strangers and pilgrims on earth, help us by true faith and a godly life to prepare for the world to come, doing the work you have given us to do while it is day, before the night comes when no one can work, and when our last hour comes. Support us by your power and receive us into your heavenly kingdom through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. We sing our recessional hymn, which is on page 794.
Thank you.